What's happening, Patrick?
Hello, Travis. Welcome.
What are we talking about today, Patrick?
Today we're talking about running.
Can't wait.
Tips to get better.
Let's do it.
My name is Travis Young. I've been a drug addict, gambling addict, alcoholic, and because of this, I was suicidal. But that was 2016. I'm now over 6 years sober, dad of three, and have a thriving gym. On this podcast, I'll take you through my personal stories, my failures, and my success. Also, my team and I will be taking you on our journey through business, fitness, and personal development. So welcome to the show of Becoming Reborn.
Hi, Patrick.
Great job, Travis.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
So to give you guys the reasons why we are doing this kind of a podcast is running is really popular at the moment. There's run clubs that are flying everywhere. There's events that are going crazy. A lot of people are signing up for runs, and a lot of people are running that either haven't run much before or they haven't run for a while and they're trying to get back into it and get faster. So we're doing quite a few events through the gym. Off the top of your head, Travi, what are our members doing?
So we've got Gold Coast, Sell That A Surf.
Yep.
And then we've got High Rocks, and then we'll see how many people want to do City to Surf as well. But they're our main three.
Yeah, so the Gold Coast is there's a 10K half marathon, full marathon. We've got people in all three.
For 20 to 20.
And then later in September, there's the Sydney like running festival where there's, again, all those different distances. So heaps of runs going on, which is great. I'm going to preface this by saying that Trav and I aren't specific run coaches. We're both trainers. We have coached in a running capacity and we both have run quite a lot, but there are experts more qualified than us.
Experts than us.
But we've got experience under the belt.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the aim of this podcast is to give you guys some tips if you are starting out running, even if you've been running for a while, want to increase it, or if you want to get faster. We've got some tips that we're going to give you based off science plus experience. So how it's going to work, I'm going to give you the tip and the reasons behind it and kind of the data behind it. Trav is a much more experienced runner, especially recently. Trav's been running a lot more. So he's going to give you kind of the... In my experience, this is what has happened and why.
Yeah, I think the best way to explain us, we're really good like beginner to intermediate
coaches
for running. But then you get to that next level, like you look at like Chapo, someone like that. He's a freak.
Next level.
He's next level. Next. So we're not there, but I think we've got the coaching to part down pat. And like you said, pardon the pun, we've got the runs on the board.
Nice. Well played. But the good thing is the principle's still...
Still the same. Pretty much.
All right. So where a lot of these tips are aimed, like Trav said, at kind of beginner to intermediate runners, kind of people that are looking to do like their first 10K up to like half marathon.
Yeah.
Full marathon, things change a little bit, but these principles still ring true. So first tip when training for a running event or when trying to get faster is to follow a program.
Yes.
Crucial. Instead of just going out, eyes closed, running.
The boys, there's been a few of the boys like Billy and that. Like they just, I'm like, what runs are you doing this week? And it's like, do a 30.
Yeah, whatever I feel like.
I'm like, what part of your program are you up to? They're like, oh, I think we're into like week 10. I'm like, wait, what, run me through, what is your program? And it's like, oh, like we kind of just go about 100 Ks this week. And I'm like, what do you mean, boys? Yeah, so run. But in saying that, Billy's running fantastic.
He is.
So probably not the best example.
But how good could he be if he was following a program?
Yeah, he'd be unbelievable. Yeah. But yeah, you got to follow some sort of program depending on your fitness levels as well. And it just gives you that structure, which I'm sure we're going to dive into different types of running sessions that you should be doing.
We are. Well done.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Bob. From my personal experience, I'm not a natural long-distance runner. Never really enjoyed it. If you were to see me like 15 Ks in while running, you'd look at it and be like, something's wrong there. Like there's kind of a limp. Something looks like it's hurting. So for me, I've run two marathons.
Pat's like a mixed success truck.
Yeah, yeah. More a sprinter than a long distance runner. So I've run two marathons, and I think one of the sole reasons why I was able to was because I followed a program. Very structured, had three runs a week. Everything was like this many kilometers at this pace, this level of intensity, and I just followed that to a T, which essentially just gets your body ready for the run. So follow a program, get a program first, and stick to it. I'm also going to throw a shout out to Paddy Tegg, one of our coaches here at Reborn. He's also an unreleased, starting to be a physio. He writes really good running programs, and he's got a running strength program that he's got like three or four people on at the moment, where he does some PT sessions with them, building up running strength, but also then programs their runs for the week. Two things. One, he's a kid genius. Two, he runs faster than the wind. So he's kind of got both boxes ticked.
I don't know if he did or he said he could. Either way, it's pretty much, let's lock it in. He ran a sub 3 1K.
He did in this challenge.
He did. It did happen. Yep. So I didn't dream that.
Yep.
Fantastic.
He did. It was 2:55. And he told me his speed was 2:55. And then I checked his watch when he showed me, and it was like 1.05 kilometers. So, like, he did extra and still went under 3 minutes. It's really fast, Paddy.
Yeah. Well done. Respectfully, you can go yourself. Well done.
Yeah. So, if you would like a running program or to do some kind of running strength, contact us and we'll put you in touch with Paddy Tegg.
Is that a part of your question, the strength component, or should we? Okay, I was going to say we should dive in.
You know what? I'll go there next. So another tip for improving your running or training for an event is not to ignore strength training. So strength training is crucial, especially when you're running. A lot of people, when they increase the amount of running they do, stop or reduce the amount of strength they're doing, especially with lower body when you're doing a long distance run. If anything, you need to maintain or even do more strength training. So probably at least two lower body strength training sessions a week.
That was one of the biggest mistakes I made in the first time I was training for a marathon, as I just focused on the running and didn't focus in on any of the... Actually, there's a lot of things I didn't focus on. I just had a flashback of some of the things I didn't
do.
But like the recovery, but the strength stuff.
Yeah.
I think there's a statistic where it's like there's like 70% of runners in their first year get injured. And I reckon you could probably put that down to them not doing the strength training that goes with it, because that is as important as the run. The hard thing is when you're doing that distance running is trying to fit it all in.
And your legs can be really sore.
Yeah.
And another thing to add to that, not as important, but still trying to get some off-legs cardio. So try not to get all of the cardio training that you're doing being running, because the impact after impact after impact of doing running and your feet hitting the ground like that has a higher chance of injury. So at least one session a week, get some kind of cross-training or some kind of cardio on erg machines or something like that, or just like a normal gym session that's a cardio session.
I was going to ask, this is, I generally don't know which is better here. Do you go for something like a high intensity interval training across the ergs, or do you do the zone two longer, slower stuff across the ergs?
It depends. Kind of, you probably need to line it up with what you're doing in the running training. Like if you've got two low intensity to moderate runs a week, you could probably do a HIIT session. Yeah. If all of your runs are being banged, you probably do a zone two cardio on the machines, something like that. All right, next step is, or next, this one's a little rule that I've stuck to and Trav stuck to.
Have we?
No, we have not.
Yes.
Sorry, we spoke about this the other day. No running 2 days in a row. So if you're running four times a week, it's going to make it, some would say, impossible. Probably is, but generally a good running program would be 2 to 3 runs per week, and try not to have consecutive days of running. I saw a stat and I don't remember what it is now, but it was something like 80% higher risk of injury running 2 days consecutively, just because your body is using the same muscles, there's the same impact on the same joints and areas in your body, and if you do it 2 days in a row, your body hasn't recovered sufficiently enough. When you have a day gap in between, much better chance.
Paddy, do you remember the first, when I started running, I did two runs in one day?
Yeah, and I do remember.
I'm like, why am I so sore? Like, when did you last run? I'm like, yesterday. And you're like, oh, okay. How far did you go? I go, well, in the morning I did like 6K and in the arvo I did 8K. And you're like, what?
Why?
I don't remember why I did it. And then you're like, you shouldn't be running 2 days in a row, let alone two times in one day.
Yeah. Oh, so you did three in 2 days instead of one.
Yeah, a lesson learned, but yeah.
So pretty much we could explain this whole podcast by saying learn from our mistakes.
Yes, yeah, definitely mine. I did everything wrong. Like everything, had the wrong shoe. I was running like, what are they called? I should know this too because I love Nikes. They're just trainers.
Yeah.
Like gym shoes for, you know, I was doing 30Ks in them.
You know what? I didn't have this as a tip. You just huge, brought it up.
Huge tip.
Get a pair of shoes that suit your running style.
Yeah.
So similar to a diet, as we talk about often, Trav, what works for one person doesn't necessarily work for another person. So don't get a pair of running shoes that someone else ran in and they were really good for their feet, because everybody runs differently. And whether when their feet lands on the ground, they either pronate or supinate or in the middle. So if you live local in the Southern Shire, go see, a little shout out to Todd Ridge from the running company, he's the man. So you know, you'll get you running barefoot on a treadmill and see what your foot does when it lands, and get you an appropriate pair of shoes, because again, huge injury risk if you're running with the wrong shoes. So
it is honestly benefit. The first tip I give to someone when they come to me and say, hey, I've got an injury, do you have any suggestions of what I can do? I'm like, all right, first of all, what shoes are you running in? And they'll tell me whatever the shoes are. I'm like, all right, why did you choose those shoes? And most of the time it's because they looked good. I completely get that. And then I'm like, all right, you need to get the right shoes for your running technique. Because that's how I got injured the first time, and I had to pronate in.
Yep.
Right? And because I hadn't just started running, my legs weren't strong enough to take, you know, the constant load that I was putting them through every single week with the running. They just weren't used to it. So I had to get – and I said to Toddy, I said, I don't care what shoe it is, it just has to be Nike. There's only one shoe that would work for me. It was called Nike Structures. And these things were heavy too. Mm. They stopped making them. I don't know why. Maybe they weren't a very good shoe. But I had to wear those Nike Structures for 3 years before I could wear the flashy ones.
Wow.
And you know how much that kills me. And like, their colorways were always like black and white. And like, I think the most adventurous they got. Actually, it was pretty adventurous. It was like a navy with a pink tick. But what I'm getting at is running the shoes that are best for your technique. First of all, it's going to help you heaps when it comes to your injuries. But second of all, it's going to get you stronger long term towards running in like the Nike Vapors or the Vaporflies. The Adidas have just brought out a new. You don't care one.
I was about to say, I glazed over 10 minutes ago.
I'm so sorry, Pat.
As soon as you were talking about what shoes you wear.
I get excited about shoes, yeah. But I'm talking to the wrong person. Anyways, just get the right shoes for your running technique. It's going to save you a lot of time and hassle in terms of injuries. You're welcome.
Nice. Going back to the strength training point we spoke about and making sure that your lower body is strong enough for running, especially when you're going long distance. Do you remember when we were about to run our first marathon and what Leno said to us? This is a proper thing. So Andrew Lennon, yeah, who used to work with
he
us.
He can run.
He can absolutely run. He's an incredible running coach and long distance runner himself. He said to it, like,
I remember this.
We'd never done upstairs. A marathon before. But the furthest both of us had run was 10K, Southern Surf, or 11K. And we both just decided to do a marathon. And Leno was like, he was off office because he was like, you need to respect the marathon. We're like, nah, we're just going to run it.
And you get that now too.
Yeah, 100% agree and understand. So he was saying, like, how many half marathons you done? We're like, none. And he goes, you need to do at least 5 half marathons before you do a full. And we were both like, hey, Leonard, we're going to do it anyway. He just kind of getting under his skin. And then he said, all right, get down into a side plank position and you need to do show me how many leg lifts that you can do. So you're on one forearm and foot on the ground and the other leg straight, the top leg, and you've got to lift it up and down and see how many you can do back to back. And he said, for you to safely do a half marathon, you need to do a minimum of 30 of these in a row on one leg. And then I was like, oh, yeah, sweet. And so we went down to see how many we could do, and I think we got 10 and 11.
Yeah.
One of us got 10, one of us got 11. And he was like, you can't run this marathon. And I was like, we're going to do it anyway. And I got injured halfway through my marathon.
Yeah, I got injured too.
So
2 weeks out or 3 weeks out.
So we were pretty arrogant and kind of having a bit of a laugh. But Leno had the last laugh, didn't he?
Yeah, because your knee went out.
In the Gold Coast Marathon.
But I had the dream run. That marathon was the best marathon.
The Sydney one
was the best one of them all.
That's awesome. So follow a strength program. And if someone tells you you should be able to do this before you run, don't get all arrogant like we did. Listen to them.
And not to get too technical, but if you can't, this is not a must, this is an option, but with your shoes, try to have multiple shoes so that you don't run in the same pair of shoes every single week. It gives you more longevity in that shoe, but it gives the time shoe to kind of like literally bounce back. And if you're running constantly in the same shoe, you're actually more at risk of getting an injury too. So that's a little tip, but only optional if you can get a couple of pairs of shoes.
All right, next point is don't increase your load too quickly. So a lot of runners will...
They get excited.
Yeah, they do get excited. We've been there. And especially people either starting out doing running or, and this is probably more prevalent, people that have run before and that are getting back into running because mentally they think they can do what they used to do, but their body isn't quite ready. So often we'll see someone might do a 5K run and it goes really well and then they go, oh, sweet, like I'll do like 7 next week. So the general rule of thumb when you hear a lot of running coaches speak about increasing your load is a maximum of 10% a week, which is almost nothing. So when I've coached runners, I tend to allow them to push that a little bit further because that means if someone does a 5K run 1 week, the next week they're doing a 5.5K run. For you to get to a half marathon, you're running for bloody a year. But if you're way over that 10%, if you're going to like 50% or more increase in distance per week, it's way too much. And that's when injuries happen because that 5K might have felt sweet and then you go to do a 7 or an 8K and your body hasn't quite recovered and then bang, that's when something's going
to
go.
Yeah, this comes back to Pat's rule number one with his run to a program. You want to just slowly, incrementally go up. And if you do jump too heavily, then you're really going to find yourself... It can also, like you get injured, right? But it also gives you the false sense of security.
Definitely.
Like, yeah, I'm sweet. But that's how we get injured because you always feel fine until you don't feel fine.
Yep.
So, yeah, go up. We do normally about 1 to 2 Ks extra per week, right? Yep. So say if we're training for a half marathon, they might start around that 5 or 6, but every week they'll go up by a kilometre or 2 kilometres.
Gotcha. Next point. Now, this isn't around the technical aspects of running or injury prevention, but this one is run with either a group or a friend. And it's more around the social aspect of running because it can be a very lonely sport, but around you maintaining the motivation and discipline around continuing to run. Because what can happen is when you're running, especially if you're training for a long distance event and there's a lot of runs and a lot of dark, cold, lonely mornings, it can be really difficult to set that alarm and get up and get out and bang out 25K or something like that.
I'm going to use a couple examples here. This morning, I was talking to Joel.
Stojanovic.
Thank you, because I always say that wrong and I don't want to disrespect a man like that. And he was saying how good it is to go on runs and have conversations and how it's like therapy.
Yep.
When you're out on those runs and you're, I don't know what happens, and we'll get to it. I know what you're thinking because we're going to talk about it. When you're out on those runs, if something happens after 45 minutes or it can happen even early, but you just become very free, very relaxed, and you have these deep conversations with people that are, oh, they're riveting. Like
they really are.
Look, I don't want to take it here, but it's the only way I can kind of explain it. It's like when you're on the back end of a bender and like everyone's just talking and it's just absolute dribble, but at the same time, like it's the best chat you've ever had in your life. If you've been on a bender, you know what I'm talking about. If you haven't, like Patty's probably doesn't understand. Although
I do understand.
There was a morning and this is where I wanted to get to.
We were training for our first marathon. We had like a 34K run to do. And I still don't know why. I think I like running in random areas. Trav's like, where are we going? I'm like, here, let's just cut through this what is it, the caravan park in the back of Sylvania? And we ran in and just like...
There's a dude smoking a bowl.
Yeah, we just smelled like weed and I was like, yeah, we may not leave here alive.
Yeah.
So let's just get through here. Anyway, we're running down the like random back streets of Sylvania. Fair to say I had never been in these streets before and have never been in since. And we were like 27 Ks into 34 and we were hurting.
Hurting.
And then all of a sudden... We just, it's like your inhibitions are dropped. And I know what you're saying when you say it's like you're on the back of a bender because drugs and alcohol can drop your inhibitions. And then all of a sudden we was just telling each other how much we love each other.
Yeah.
Not like, I love you too, mate. It was like.
I respect you.
Yeah, it was like, I respect like what you've done, like where you've come from and the father you are the example that you're setting for your family and for like the whole world, like people
respect you and you.
Yeah, and we were getting full deep. That was cool.
I still remember coming down Box Road to like near Guymere. We're coming up there and we're just, you know, like I get goosebumps thinking about it now. But that what you're saying, run with someone.
Yep.
There's so many benefits from it, right? You got the added motivation, you've got that accountability. And then you've got this part. And this, you can't put money on it. Like it is better than therapy because you're having these conversations. And we've spoken about it. I don't remember when we've spoken about this, but because you're not directly having the eye contact with someone, you're much more comfortable in having that conversation. So you're running next to each other. And yes, it's as personal as it can be, but it's not as confronting as, say, sitting here and having like an awkward conversation. And you just feel so open and everything feels okay.
Yeah, especially these days, and our society is tending towards this. I've read a few like parts of books on this where 100 years ago, the only conversations you would ever have to someone is face-to-face. And when the telephone was first invented, critics of it came out and they were saying, you'll never be able to have a conversation on the phone because you're not face-to-face and you won't really know how to deal with it. And what they found the first like 5 to 10 years when the telephone was invented, people probably couldn't have a conversation over the phone because it was heaps weird because there was no body language and you couldn't take the non-verbal cues that you get from talking to someone. Now, we've got the generation where we talk on the phone heaps, so we're sweet with it. We've grown up with it. The future generation coming is even going to be worse because even they feel uncomfortable talking on the phone, so they just text and they pick up little cues that we won't get, our kids. But what I'm getting at here is when you've grown up like we have, it can be very confronting having a face-to-face conversation. We're sweet with it. Naturally, we're pretty confident people and we like having those kind of conversations. Yeah. A lot of people don't. When you are side by side with someone, like when you're running, you're not looking directly at them, it's like a wall comes down and you open up a bit more and you speak a bit deeper than what you potentially would if you were looking face-to-face with someone.
Yeah.
And it's why you'll often find when you're driving in a car, you can have a really deep conversation because
that's
two things.
The conversation was
The two things. First of all, you're not looking at each other. And secondly, when your body is doing something, but it isn't incredibly active in it, there's something where, again, inhibitions get dropped and you tend to open up a little bit more. So when you're driving, you don't need your full focus on the road, as in like to change lanes and put a blinker on and stuff like that, but you're still actually doing something.
Yeah.
So there is something where you're not only thinking about what you're saying, so you tend to open up a little bit more.
I've got two things and we're going to go on a tangent. And
we're already pretty deep into one.
So first one, when you're having these conversations with someone as well, how do I explain this better than I am starting? When you're able to have these harder conversations, right, I think it's why me and you don't have very many, if any, like issues outside of like the normal general stuff, right? I'm not explaining this well, but I know you're going to be able to explain this better than me in a second. But we don't suffer from depression or anything like that because we are very open. We're very different to most men's relationships where me and Pat can, like, at the drop of a hat, have the deepest conversation. It happened after one of our podcasts about 3 weeks ago. We had like an hour and a half conversation about our kids. But on runs in particular, you open up so much more and it's a way of like a free counseling session. But I honestly think it helps a lot more things in your life as well. Because if you're able to open up and get those things out off your chest and out of your mind, it frees so much weight. Like I know for me in particular, with my own problems, I make them out 10 times worse in my own mind. And I think a lot of us do. But when you say these things out loud and you have someone that can, you know, talk you through it, or even just to hear you out, it automatically lifts the weight off your shoulders. So that's a big part about running with someone. I hope I eventually got to my point. I know that I didn't get there as cleanly as I like, but that I didn't really know how to word that. Second one, now this is way off topic, but still on the topic of conversation. You're talking about our kids, right? And how, and I said this to my kids the other day, or I was doing the dishes in the morning before we were going to school, right? And I was talking to them, and neither of them were answering me back. These are my two boys. And then I just said it as a throwaway comment. I looked up and one of them like poked his head up, and I said, "It's so sad for your generation. You guys aren't going to know how to communicate with each other." And then like Jet just looked at me and he's just like, "Okay." And then Ace popped his head up and goes, "Which generation?" I said, "You're like your age group, like, you know, between like your age and like Jet and more like around that age group." And he goes, "What's conversation?" Oh, no, communication, sorry. You're not going to be able to communicate. He goes, "What's communicate?" I said, "It's where you, like, have conversation. Do you speak to people?" And both of them, like Jet and Ace, were looking over at the couch at me while I was doing the dishes, and both put their head straight back in their iPad. I just went, "Oh, whatever." Did the dishes, and I'm like, "All right, boys, let's go." So I took him out there. We're walking to school this day. And then we got down the driveway, and Ace, being a deeper thinker than Jetty, looks at me and goes, "Dad, can you teach us how to have conversations?"
No.
And I've done this with Jet, and we've spoken about this about Cooper and Jet. That's mine and Val and Pat's eldest boys. And Jet struggles to have conversations with people. He's very shy, he's very introverted, and he gets very awkward. Like, I remember Patty coached him or something one day or something, and I was like, "Oh, go up and shake Patty's hand," and Pat was doing something, and he's like, anyway, he put his hand up, and then like Pat would look away, and like not intentionally, obviously, but like it took him like three goes to get your hand. Poor Jetty. Anyways, so I've taught Jet previously, hey, when you're having conversations, you need to be able to carry the conversation, continue the conversation, to ask questions. Otherwise, it just gets awkward, and it comes across rude. And I go, "Do you want to be rude, Jet?" He's like, "No, I don't want to be rude." So I said, "All right, Jet, you teach Ace how to have a conversation." And so they proceeded, right? And Jet's like, "Hey, Ace, how was your day yesterday?" And this is Jet stock standard, because he's very good at reciting what I say. "How was your day yesterday?" Ace answered. He goes, "What was your favorite part?" He said what it was, and then he said, "Why was your favorite part?" Right? That was how the conversation went. And then I said, "All right, Ace, now your turn to Jet." And he did the same thing to Jet. And then we went back and forth, and then Ace asked me like how my day was, and he was asking about Gray. And he's asking about like how I felt about Green. And then he goes, "So how does that make you feel, Dad?"
Nice.
And I'm like, "Good question." Because it wasn't just the stock standard, you know, that kind of stuff. He's like, "How does that make you feel?" And I was like, "Whoa." But then by the time we got to the school, right, so I had Mimi on my shoulders. By the time we got to the school, me and Mimi were like 10, 15 minutes behind. And Ace and Jet just spoke the whole way.
That's great.
And had a conversation. So where I'm getting to, and a long story short, is like, yeah, we're talking about running, but real quickly, teach kids how to have conversations, because it's going to be a very valuable asset for them later on when 90% of the kids can't have communication. They can't have conversations, sorry, and they struggle with communication. If you can teach your kids how to communicate now, which is what we do very, very comfortably now, but it's not going to be like that in 10 years.
Big time.
We said it yesterday. A couple of our trainers said they hate making phone calls.
Yeah.
That's a phone call.
Yeah.
Like, imagine like the difference between a phone call and having a live interaction. Oh, my God. So, yeah, that's a little offside tip.
Yeah, a little parenting tip in a running podcast. Love that. But I completely agree, because even now, we listen to a lot of podcasts, and I listen to podcasts about successful people that run businesses, and they often say, and especially people of our generation or maybe even 5-10 years older, they will hire someone based, like, a big part of whether they hire someone or not is if they have a firm handshake, can look you in the eye and and stare you and have a conversation, as opposed to someone that's very introverted and can't have that face-to-face conversation. Yeah. In the future, like you mentioned, those skills are going to be less and less common because people are going to be find it so difficult having that face-to-face conversation. So I don't see that as a negative for anyone who's a parent out there with kids. I see it as a massive positive because if you teach those kids, and yeah, it's kind of the old-fashioned chivalry stuff, like I always teach my sons to shake a man's hand, look him in the eye and say hello to them and tell them your name, as opposed to shaking hands and kind of looking away from them. Because those skills are going to be so more uncommon in the future, it's a massive opportunity for your kids to be so much further socially and professionally and in their careers if they have those skills. So teach your kids how to have a conversation, how to shake someone's hand, how to look them in the eye, because it's crucial.
I couldn't agree more, Patrick. Well done for us going off on that tangent. We're great.
Times three. All right, last running tip. Don't worry, I'm going to go back and wrap them all up because of how many tangents we tend to go down. The last running tip is, when I first heard this, I didn't believe it, and it took me a while to believe it. Run slow to run fast. So, yeah, you it probably took you even longer.
Took me ages.
So you need to have variation in your running. A lot of people, when they start out running and doing running training, is every time they run as fast as they can. And the hard thing is when you start out and you do that, that's going to get you a lot of benefits. But you just running is going to get you a lot of benefits. So the fact that you're sprinting every run hasn't made things better. Once you get a bit more experienced in your running, you then need to vary the tempo and have a different focus with each run, as opposed to going at the same heart rate, at the same intensity, and the same level of effort every run. So, Trav, how did you find your running change when you shifted, and what did you shift to?
I got more results. Okay, so Pat told me once, I was going for a long run and I'm like, oh, I'm going to try and go fast. He's like, you should never do both.
Yep. Never change two variables.
What does that mean? He goes, if you're running long, run long and slow. Don't run long and fast. If you're running fast, don't run long.
Yep.
I was like, oh, okay. Didn't do it. So what happened with me is that I just plateaued. I just stayed at the same and I couldn't get any faster. And I stayed around. I remember it was around that 5 minute pace. And I couldn't break the 5 minute pace for ages until when I went on my long runs, I went slower. I ran around that 5:15 pace. And then when I started doing my interval stuff, that's when I could really bang it. And then I noticed, lo and behold, my longer runs just started getting faster. But my heart rate was still staying the same and I still felt comfortable. I wasn't thinking about my pace, but it was naturally just happening on its own. So the changes that I noticed straight away was not overnight, by the way, which I hate. It took like a couple months, but everything just started. But in saying that, like there wasn't overnight, it just felt like every run just was naturally getting quicker. I wasn't trying to go out there like I previously was, where I was like, I'm just going to jam it. But you just slowly get faster and faster.
It's good.
Without even meaning to.
Yeah. So generally when you're increasing your distance, you'll have a long run each week, which slowly gets a little bit bigger or further every time. Generally, when you're doing those long runs, don't worry about speed. And in fact, sometimes you have to hold yourself back to run slower. But then in your shorter runs, you either have an interval-based run or just a shorter distance run. That's when you increase your speed.
Yeah.
So either improve your speed or increase the distance. Try not to do both at the same time.
Let's give some examples of intervals.
Yep.
Okay, so like we do Thursday run club every week and we pretty much just try, you just get us to do hills.
Yep.
Great form of intervals.
Yep.
Because it doesn't take much thinking. It's just get to the hill, run as fast as you can. When you get to the hill, then come down slowly and regress. Yep.
And when you are running faster and doing sprints, there's a less chance of injury going up a hill because there's less impact on your joints. Coming down a hill is the opposite.
So it's a nice, easy one to start with.
Yeah. But another good example of an interval-based session is some kind of fartlek variation, which is running a certain time or distance fast and then that same distance slow. So generally, if someone, let's use your example, Trav, where you were running around 5 minute pace, an interval based run that I would give you, for example, is, all right, you're going to go, let's call it 500 meters at a time.
Yeah.
Okay. And you're going to do a 500 meter interval slow,
yep.
and you're going to go at about 5:30 pace. And then you get into a 500 meter interval fast at about a 4:30 pace. So from that 5 minute pace, you're getting about a minute difference in your fast and slow intervals, meaning your 4:30 pace is a lot quicker than you normally run. You're going to need time to recover, but you're teaching your body to be able to recover in that slow 500 meters without actually having to stop and walk.
God, they hurt too.
They really do hurt.
Yeah.
But
what we do is like the 1K on, 1K off, and that's a killer.
That is a killer because that's a long interval.
That's so long.
But it's easier to track than 500 because your watch will vibrate when you hit the K.
Yeah, and for those OCD people as well, it looks really neat.
It does.
On your run app, depending on what app
you use. Yeah, use Strava. It looks cool.
It looks really cool. It's really the short one, the long one. That's really good. So that's a really simple one. There's a tempo style run. Actually, I only learned what tempo meant about 3-4 weeks ago.
Let's see.
Tempo wrote it. And that's where you run somewhere between comfortable and uncomfortable. So you're not just jogging along, but it's a little bit, you know, a little bit more, but you're not uncomfortable either. So you always give a good example. If you're running comfortably, you should be able to speak.
You should be able to have a conversation. Yep.
Yeah. And then you touched on it before. There's like you could use it as more of a time trial. So where you just go for a short distance, but like a 5K run. So it might be a 1K run. It might be just something really short, or it might be like a 5K, but you go and you go as hard as you possibly can. 5K time trial is quite possibly the hardest run.
Horrific.
It's horrific.
Horrific. Another good interval if we're pulling back ability level for people that are just starting out, for example, maybe want to build to running 1-5K.
If I know exactly what you're saying here, this is going to be weird.
Eye pulse?
Oh, my God.
Do you know what? I knew that you knew. I don't know how we're weird like that. So
that was weird.
And it's not like we've ever spoken about it, too. Trying to hold your hand. So
yeah, that's cute ass.
So if you're just starting out and want to build up your running, is to go to either a path or a road with light poles, and you might start by run to one light pole, walk one light pole, run one, walk one, and keep going for, say, 20 minutes, 30 minutes. And then a step up from that, you could run two, walk one, run two, walk one, and then following run a couple of weeks later, run three, walk one, and then you might get to the point where you'd be able to run 1 kilometer or 1 kilometer without stopping, something like that.
Yeah, it's cool. And I just thought of another one that we used to do where you kind of using Learmonth ran you as your target. If you've got like a block, right, so streets that go, you know, down one way, then you go left, 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 like we used to have it.
In a square.
Yeah, in a square. Thank you. Appreciate it. You choose one side. So whenever let's just say you're running south or north, there you're going to be your hard like run, and then when you're going east and west, that's nice. When you go slow.
Call it like a footy oval.
Yes.
You're running out of footy oval, you go the 100 metres down the sideline, hard, turn left, run across the try line,
easy,
slow, or whether it's your walk or your slower pace. Yeah.
See, that's why he's here. He's just brilliant. He just gets me, and then he's able to translate to everyone else.
I am a translator.
I love that for you.
Now, I am going to mention lightly fueling before runs as another tip. A lot of people decide to do a running event or to run more to lose weight, okay, or to lose body fat. My suggestion is not to run to run. Eat better to lose weight, okay, because running is quite inefficient at losing weight. And I don't want to go down a tangent around why that is, but a lot of people, especially when the distances are getting quite large, won't fuel properly before a run. So even though a lot of these tips are aimed at someone, say, doing their first 5K, 10K, maybe half marathon, the amount of, say, carbohydrates that you're eating before a run and hydration doesn't really matter up to about like an hour and a half. Anything north of that really does matter, and you need to make sure if you're going more than about an hour and a half that you're eating enough carbs the night before and or morning of your run, and that you're hydrated enough during.
Yep, I had for my first 30K run, I took 3 snakes with me.
That's mad.
Yeah, it didn't work very well. I creamed a lot, hurt. And I actually called Chloe when I was about a K and a half from home saying, I don't think I'll make it. I think she called me a pussy.
Oh.
Yeah.
So you ran 31.
I got home.
Yeah, fair enough. That's good. So they're all of our main tips. I'm going to go through again and kind of list the first. Quickly, sorry.
On that last part, if you're doing like a marathon, you should be having gels through your run. Trial them before you do your run. There's reasons why that you should trial towards just so your stomach gets used to. I'm going to say that as nicely as I can.
Yeah.
But trial them weeks and weeks out before, because some work for, it's again going back to what we said, what works for some, it doesn't work for everyone. But yeah, trial them out because, yeah, some of them have reactions to the body.
Learn from our mistakes. All I'll say is both of my marathons, I didn't test the gels prior, different gels each time. And the second marathon, I was running the Gold Coast Marathon, and all I'm going to say is I really had to find a toilet, and I found one. So trust me, test your gels first. So going back to, we started with five. We picked one up along the way. Six main tips, but it was a crucial one. I'm glad we got to it. Six main tips for anyone starting out running or if you want to get better at running. First tip, follow a program.
Yep. You got to have some sort of structure in life too.
Nice. All right, I'm going to say the tip and throw to you, and you're just going to give me a line.
Okay.
Second tip, get a pair of fitted shoes.
Preferably Nike. No, whatever's best for your technique.
Nice. Third tip, where possible, don't run 2 days in a row.
You're going to increase your injury up to 80%. Is that right, Patrick?
Injury risk, yeah. Nice. Next one, similar. Don't increase your running load too quickly.
Yeah. In between 10 and 20%.
Nice. Next one, maintain strength training.
Crucial, especially for injuries. Absolutely.
Next one, which we discussed for about 25 minutes, run with a group or a friend.
And they teach your kids how to have conversations. This just makes it much more enjoyable. And you will find on those runs when you get into really deep conversations, it's like you didn't run at all.
And last tip, run slow to run fast. Get some variation in your running.
Yeah, learn from my mistakes on that one, because like I probably plateaued for like 6 to 8 months. And then on the other side, don't just do slow runs as well.
Yeah.
You have to do the intervals as well. You're not going to get any results if you're just going to keep doing zone two sessions as well.
Great.
Which I know everyone wants to lean into because they're much more enjoyable. Their intervals hurt.
Yeah. So there's your six running tips, guys, plus a few life lessons and parental lessons too. That's just how we do it. And if you would like a running program, then contact us and we'll put you in touch with Paddy Tech.
And if you want shoes and you live in the Sydney, let's just say Sydney, go see Todd Ridge, the running company at Kira. He's the goddamn man.
Well done. He nailed that.
Love you. They always say congratulations. Work so hard, forgot how to vacation.